myths, legends, and lies. You wouldn't believe where we're at today. We are at the James family farm. Now, when you say James family farm, the first thing you've got to think about is James. Who would that be? Well, that would only be the most notorious outlaws ever. And that would be Jesse James and his brother Frank. Now, we're at the homestead of the original homestead of the James family. It's been in the family for over 150, 175 years, and is absolutely spectacular. And take a look real quick at this farmhouse. Jesse James was really getting to be a pain in the railroad's life. And so what they did was they sent Pinkerton out to this very cabin, and they got word that the two brothers were in this cabin. Now, in this very building, those Pinkerton came to this house with a bomb. They wrapped this bomb in cloth, lit it on fire, and threw it through this very window on that side of the house. Now they're doing some reconstruction now, as you see. That bomb was thrown in to the house, and so when that bomb came in, kicked that ball that was on fire into the fireplace. Well, it exploded, killing the young son and also taking the arm of Esmeralda off, and later in life had to be amputated. Well, and they weren't even here at that time. So what's happened is now there's all this outcry from how evil the Pinkerton company was, killing an innocent boy and maiming her. And so she got free railroad service the rest of her life because they felt so bad on the errors and the mistakes they made. But this is fascinating that this is the very house, the very room. Now they're doing some renovation because of this age of this house in 1822. So, you know, you're looking at pretty old house right here. So it's fascinating to be out here and to really feel the history that you can coming to the James farm. Look how beautiful this is. Now this is the original grave site of Jesse James right here, and then it was moved later, but originally she said she wanted to make sure that she kept a hold of this area so she could keep an eye on him. J-Shrek, myths, legends, and lies. When you think of outlaws, who do you think of? Well, I know the guy that I think of first, and that's Jesse James. Probably one of the most legendary outlaws in any time. You know, anybody around the world, if you ask them to know about United States outlaws, who would they come up with? Even
from outside the United States. And they'd come up with Jesse James because he is legendary, right? You know, and what made Jesse James so legendary, right? What made him this big myth? You know, when you talk about myths, legends, and lies, so what's the myth of Jesse James? Jesse James was really a configuration of fiction, in my opinion. Now, how would I say that? There was a writer for the Kansas City Star named John Newman Edwards, and he is responsible as much for the legend of Jesse James than anyone else. He actually glorified Jesse James and coined him the modern day Robin Hood. And you know, the fact of the matter is that there's no proof that Jesse James ever gave back to the poor after stealing from the rich. There is history that he was a cold-blooded killer, a psychopath. You know, when it came down to only a couple men that probably wouldn't let somebody go, you know, Bloody Bill Anderson would have been on that list, probably the most ruthless. And now Jesse James' father was a preacher, and they were slaveholders, so they were in an area in Missouri near Kearney that was called Little Dixie, and he had a loving mother. Well, that father went west to preach to the miners and died, so young Jesse didn't have a father. His mother remarried. That didn't work. And then she remarried again to a doctor who had a substantial amount of money. So they weren't poor people. When Jesse was 16 years old, because of an incident that happened with his stepfather, he was bound and determined to fight for the Confederates. So he joined the cause, which was the Confederate cause, of the guerrillas. Now, the Confederates had been run out of most of the area of Missouri-Kansas line, and so the Confederates that were fighting at that time were more guerrilla, and Quantrell was strong at that time, and Jesse cut his teeth at 16 years old as a cold-blooded killer. So the thing about Jesse James is that, you know, he was totally a sociopath that would kill you in a drop of a hat. Fast forward to after the war, you know, Jesse had an opportunity along with Frank. They moved to Kentucky after the war, and they both, you know, wanted to try a different life. And Frank liked that new life, but you know, Jesse didn't. You know, Jesse liked the limelight. You know, he was a gambler, and I was told that he wasn't a very good gambler. So one of the reasons that he had to go back to robbing was the fact that he wasn't very good at cards, and he wasn't very good at much anything else, with the exception of the fact that, you know, he's a ruthless killer. You know, they lasted 15 years, so it shows how the people of that area were very supportive to the Confederate cause. Now, even when they went to Northfield, and they went up to Northfield to rob the bank, he ruthlessly killed the guy that wouldn't open the safe for him, shot him in the head. You know, that's just what he did. He was not this romantic, legendary bank robber trying to support his cause that a lot of people, you know, wanted to believe that he was. And, you know, even when he escaped there, and the fact that he got back home 500 miles made him another legend that, you know, my God, this guy's unbelievable skill set allowed him to be able to go to and be able to get 500 miles without his horse, right? And nothing to eat and no water, and somehow miraculously him and his brothers, now the youngers who were shot to pieces, you know, Cole actually had 11 gunshot wounds, which is unbelievable. And they were captured by one of the largest manhunts in history at that time to find these bank robbers, and the James brothers got away, which made them even more of a legend. You know, one thing that started to happen though was that the Southerners that had lost their position in the government after the war reconstruction slowly got back those places in legislature. And so there came a point where even the violence of Jesse James was at a point where they didn't really even want to support him anymore. The governor of Missouri, Crittenden, actually put a bounty on Jesse and Frank's head, even though at this time Frank had decided that, you know what, he really didn't want to live that lifestyle any longer. And he wanted to make a change, and Jesse couldn't. He was addicted to the lifestyle. He was addicted to the fame. His ego was so big at that time, he couldn't really do anything else. So he got another group of the Fords together to start another gang to do more bank robberies without Frank. And the governor, Crittenden, had actually talked with the Ford brothers and told them that he would pardon them if they killed Jesse James. There was a reward, and they'd be pardoned. Well, so on that fateful day, Jesse did something he never did. He took his guns off, and guess what? Bob Ford decided that was the perfect opportunity and shot him in the head. You know, the amazing thing about those guns is they, at that point you had to click the trigger back. So when Jesse James was on that chair, adjusting that picture, dusting that picture, whatever he was doing, which is kind of funny in itself, and he heard that click, he knew it was done. I mean, he had two seconds between the time that he was shot in the head and killed. The funny thing is they actually tried the Fords for murder. They sentenced him to hang, and then Crittenden come in and pardoned him. And that didn't set well. And so they actually toured around, and he actually toured and told people how he killed Jesse James. And, you know, it was really important that they put, even on his tombstone, killed by a coward. And, you know, one thing I will say about Jesse James, he was so violent, and there's no other way that you were going to get that guy. I mean, and you know, the way that they lived their life, I mean, it was fitting that they lived by the sword and they died by the sword. You know, that's just the way it was. And you know, the funny thing was, guess who else got assassinated? Yeah, right, Bob Ford did. So, you know, live by the sword, die by the sword. You know, Jesse James did have a fascinating life. I mean, he did become this Robin Hood type character to these people until he ran out of use for those political causes. And even John Newman eventually couldn't even justify his ruthless killing. And so, you know, he became a legend. Was he a myth? Absolutely. The real myth of what we think of Jesse James as this this whimsical character that robbed from the rich and gave to the poor is total crap. The reality of it was he was a ruthless, bloodthirsty killer. He was violent. You know, he was the youngest of the group, younger, who was very skilled, and so was his brother Frank, but they didn't run that gang because they weren't as ruthless as Jesse was. Jesse was a cold-blooded killer, but you know what? That is how it went down in history. And it's a fascinating story, it really, truly is. In search of Jesse James.
I'm in the cemetery of Mount Olivet in Kearney, Missouri, at the gravesite of the infamous Jesse James. Jesse James, his original grave was here, but it was taken apart. People would chip away the tombstone so there was absolutely nothing left. So we saw what was left at it at the farmhouse in the museum, because people would steal his grave. But he's here with Zerelda. original James farm. Now, this building was built in 1822. It wasn't originally the James family, though. It was originally another family. The James family bought this later. And Jesse and Frank's dad was a preacher. Well, that's a lot of people don't realize that. Now, there is a slave cabin on the facility, which is one of the reasons that they were pro-South, right? And that's why they were on the side of the Confederates. Now,